So let's dive into the panel and let them introduce themselves, starting with Dhirendra.
Yeah, good morning.
Your camera is switched off, Professor Srar.
Thank you.
Good morning and good afternoon, Professor. I am Dhirendra Shukla. I am a faculty at Indian Institute of Management, Udaipur. Before joining IIM Udaipur, I had a brief stint with IIM Kozhikode also, and before that, I completed my PhD from IIM Lucknow. I teach strategic management and social entrepreneurship, and I have research interest in this domain, particularly social entrepreneurship and corporate social responsibility. Thanks so much.
Hi, I'm Manas Satpathy from PRADHAN, Professional Assistant for Development Action, that focuses on promoting well-being of communities in the rural areas of Central India tribal belt. And it's a 37-year-old organization, and I am there for last 30 years in the sector with the organization.
Hello,
Thank you.
great. Thanks, Manas. Hello, everyone. Good, great to be here this morning with everyone. I'm Megha from Dasra, and I have switched over actually from corporate sector to Dasra, but Dasra is really a bridge between the nonprofit organizations as well as funders. We've been around for the last 20 years, serving both these communities, helping nonprofits raise funds, but also utilize those funds more effectively. And at the same time, with funders, helping them think about their giving in a more thoughtful and long-term manner. Dasra is a Sanskrit word, and it means enlightened giving.
Thank
Over
you.
to you.
Good morning, everyone. I am Satya. I am heading Basics Group. I've been with Basics for the last 25 years from the inception. Currently, Basics is working on livelihood promotion services, importantly in the agriculture, targeting the small and marginal farmers, and then skill building for the youth in formal sector. And then we are also providing financial inclusion services and the consulting and the action research part. So our financial arm is broadly sustainable. It is able to raise funds, and it's going on. But all other companies, it's a very tough task to really, sustain. That's about me. Thank you.
Hi, good morning, everyone. My name is Vijay Pratap Singh Aditya. I'm CEO and co-founder of Ek Gaon. Ek Gaon is a social enterprise which focuses on rural India, working on connecting farmers to markets and farmers and the rural communities to services. This has been our focus for the last 20 years. What we are looking at is connecting the value chain so that we can transfer some portion of the equity and the value chain towards the farmers and rural communities. That's what we do. Of late, we have started some work in Northeast, focusing on agri entrepreneurship. We have set up an agri technology incubator, first of its kind in the Northeast region, and we work in pan India across multiple states with farmer producer organizations and farmers.
Thank you, Vijay, and thank you, panelists. As you know, we have been affected by COVID across the globe, and especially informal economy in developing country has been badly hit by this infection, because most of the people who work in informal sector has to work day to day and earn day to day. And when we put close down and everything, these are the people who are badly affected. At the same time, we found, at least in Australia, in my opinion, there are many social enterprise which has rose to occasion and created wonderful either application or solutions to solve some of the issues, especially for elderly people who are single, who are living alone. For them, they had a remarkable job. So my understanding is that similar initiatives, activities might have happened in India. So from your experience, how COVID has affected informal sector and how social enterprise or social entrepreneurship is trying to overcome those negative effect of COVID-19. Now, with the same order, with Diana first, and then subsequently Manas, Megha, Satya, and then Vijay.
Yeah. So I will talk about for-profit social enterprises with whom I have been interacting in recent times, particularly in Udaipur. So maybe some of our esteemed co-panelists will talk about non-profits also. So regarding this so during my recent interactions with the social entrepreneurs based in Udaipur, what I came to learn that they are facing huge challenges, not only in terms of their operational and logistical, but also it's kind of the strategic direction related challenges. Like I see that in order to pandemic and this lockdown, it has impacted the revenue stream of the social enterprises. They are in kind of financial distress. So some of them are trying very hard to cope up with this kind of situation. Where I see that, I had interaction with one of the organizations here, which was kind of present in a, it had a wider scope. It was present in technology related business also. It was also present in agriculture producer related business. In the technology related business, it was primarily engaged through women entrepreneurs in the rural areas who were kind of the channel partners of this particular organization, and was able to get a good amount of revenue through that particular business segment. But because of this pandemic, this particular segment has been hit very hard. And now they're facing a huge financial crunch. Now, how this organization is trying to cope up? So because this has some kind of reach in the rural villages through this, through their agricultural domain. Now they're trying to focus more on this particular agricultural domain and also trying to engage some of the women entrepreneurs in this domain so that they can retain these women entrepreneurs in their particular network. So this is something like this organization was quite present in, and it has a bit wider scope. So it is at least trying to cope up with this kind of situation. But the same thing is not true for the organization which are present in very niche segment. If I say like a particular handicraft based social enterprise in Udaipur, it was primarily engaged in kind of producers which were sold through malls and other retail outlets. Now this organization is facing a huge impact because of the lockdown and also like, so how it is going, like for this organization, it is very difficult to even pivot its current business model. It is trying to engage some of the employees or workers through by producing masks and all. But still, it is very difficult for this organization to cope up. So having said this, I would like to focus one of the ideas to cope up that we also learn from theory is that whenever such kind of crisis comes up, the people have to learn and innovate very fast. They have to respond to this kind of situation in a manner so that they remain survive. But still, this survival is a challenge, and it is not only that innovation and faster learning could bring, but also they kind of looking for some kind of institutional support, not only from the government, but from the entire community of organizations. So that is one thing. But having said that, I also, like one question which came to my mind while interacting with this these entrepreneurs, like in the pursuit of financial sustenance or survival, like is it possible that this kind of organization may drift in terms of their social mission also? Like what I am saying this, like I see this organization which I was talking about as the first organization which was engaged in technology and then agriculture, it is also it is using the same channel to distribute some of the essential goods which are essentially FMCG products. And from the long term direction perspective, this organization is thinking to engage more into this kind of distribution of FMCG products through these women entrepreneurs. Now, in one way, it is trying to engage these women entrepreneurs, but at the same time, what kind of producers would be going through this channel? That is also something like that will define the overall mission of this organization. So that is one thing which I would like to learn a bit from our esteemed co-panelists who have been successful practitioners. Like, is it possible that the pursuit of financial sustenance is going to impact the kind of social or the balance between the social and commercial mission of the organization? Yeah, so thanks. That's all from my side.
Manas?
Yes. Hi. Good morning, everybody. So in Pradhan, we are, as I have already said, we are focusing on the Central India Tribal Belt. The challenges are huge. As already my previous speaker had pointed out, Dhirendra, one of the major challenges is mobilizing resources to work in the villages and address the challenges. Many corporates who are supporting us have already requested us, who have approved projects to us, have requested us to reduce the budget. And second, in such time when the there are constraints to travel. We are not able to meet new donors or approach new entities to for support. So that is a major challenge that we are facing. But still, we are trying our best to reach out to our existing donors, whoever can. Like Ajin Premji Philanthropic Initiative has come in a big way to support us in such a time. Second biggest challenge is even to interact with the villagers. We can't go to the villages. We can't organize large meetings. So that is another big challenge, to understand them fully, to understand their constraints, rather than only pushing what is available. We have to also understand their situation, their constraints, their ideas to shape all the interventions. That is a constraint. Third is, of course, to one positive thing that has happened, because the challenge is so huge, it has made various stakeholders to come together to address the challenge. So our relationship with government, with local governance, with other NGOs working in the area, that has improved. In many blocks, we have formed coalitions to address the issues that people faced in the last 2-3 months. That's a positive thing that has happened, but still, constraint is that we are not able to meet physically. We only talk to Zoom call or Google Meet. So that is there. We are not able to meet each other, deliberate on the issues much. But so at the same time, I will say it has provided opportunities for us to be more efficient. Like the digital divide which was there between the rural and urban has been bridged to an extent. Even our villages, we have given tablets to the trained women members, and we are using those to have discussions with the villagers. We are using Google Meet to discuss with all stakeholders, even donors. So this is an opportunity. And because there is a now joint action by various stakeholders in most of the blocks, including PRI members, we are able to identify the needs of the community and address them through available schemes, programs of government. That way we have ensured that most of the things that is declared, that were declared by government during last 2 months, food grains, cash income, how most of the people get it. And we have done that. We have trained volunteers in each village. Actually, all the community service providers that we had promoted for various livelihood programs have become now volunteers to understand the issues in the villages and extend all kinds of support to link them with government programs. So that is done in a large way. So there have been challenges, and we have identified opportunities in that and tried to reach out to all the members. Around 8 lakh, 9 lakh women members we have been able to reach during that 2 months. And plans have been made to have a better Kharif crop this time and more engagement under MGNREGA. These two are there. So we are trying our best to revive rural economy and address the issues. Thank you.
Thank you, Madam. Megha?
Great. Yeah. Thank you. So I had actually three perspectives that I wanted to share with the audience today. So one is really, so first starting with nonprofits, right? So while it's been about 3 months now since the pandemic has broken, and a lot of focus has gone around the relief work, and rightfully so, because relief is the need of the hour at that point in time. But what we are seeing at Dasra is now we need to start conversations around resilience and more long-term sustainability. And so while relief has been kind of taken care of, what we are now engaging with nonprofits to understand is what is their financial sustainability. A little bit of the previous speakers, as they kind of mentioned, right? So in the NGO space, we are almost always talking about scaling up. But this is the first time that the pandemic is actually pushing us to think about contracting our programs, actually rethinking our programs, which as a sector, we are not actually used to thinking about contracting. And so if we are thinking about contracting, then really it's about a time to look within and think about what is my financial sustainability? What is actually my institutional resources? There are organizations who are having to fire their team members because funds are really available only for the next 9 months to 12 months. And so what does that funding cycle really look like? So I would kind of say, in a way that I'm loosely using the word positive implication, but the pandemic has pushed the nonprofit organizations to look within and think about their health. The second perspective is from the funder side. So we all are hearing that CSR, about 30 to 60% of CSR funds are actually going to be cut out, and which is going to have a massive implication on the funding scenario for the sector. Which is pretty much true. But what we are also observing is that a lot of individuals or philanthropists, as we talk about, they are actually stepping up to the situation, right? So we are observing that there are individuals who are genuinely keenly interested to support and participate in the sector, or have actually given a lot more than they would normally give up, that they would normally give or contribute to the sector. What we are also seeing is foundations are more so coming together. Manas was saying, they are coming together, they are talking about what their grants should look like in the future and how can they think through giving. Of course, a lot of funds are getting chalked out under the bracket of COVID. And so what does that mean for organizations is a big challenge to understand, because there is a possibility to also have a mission drift that everybody has to now rethink about their programming and give a COVID angle. But the good news is that the individuals and foundations have shown extreme empathy towards the situation, and they are actually rising to the situation and contributing. A good thing that's happening is also a lot of flexible funding is being offered to organizations. Especially foundations, are actually releasing their milestones, deliverables as they were defined, and rethink about those, contribute to some of those funds towards salaries, rents, which is required for the next 12 to 24 months. And the last perspective that I would like to share is something at Dasra that we are exploring, which is called Philanthropy for Common Good. And so we've heard about, we know Wikipedia, and there are certain digital platforms that actually are built for the common good. Information is available for any and every stakeholder to come and participate. And so given that this pandemic has actually pushed us to collaborate and think about how do you solve the problem, or how do you kind of take care of yourself in the current situation, it actually gives us an opportunity to come together, collaborate, may you be government, nonprofit, funders, ultimately to keep community at the center, right? So we are all serving and accountable to the community. And so what does that community need? And for that common good, how can we all bring together and leverage our strengths? And could we actually think about creating philanthropy for common good as a charter versus our individual agendas is what we are noticing. And Dasra being a platform that plays that role of facilitator and collaborator is where we are looking at our next 24 months to be. Over to you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Sadhya?
Yeah, thank you. As I understand that, all social enterprises are essentially working on social causes and concerns. And, all of them are really not sustainable to a good extent. The moment an enterprise becomes sustainable, I think it will go out of the social enterprise bracket. That's what is my understanding. This situation has really forced everyone to kind of become more efficient and use the communication, the digital media extremely well. And travels have come down. So that's the positive part of it. And everybody is obviously meeting the requirements of social distance and making, following the minimal, the cares and all that. But the real challenge is that, for the last 3 months, nothing happened in the ground. Our people did not move in the ground. So that amounts to a complete operational, loss. And as you know that typically all these enterprises will have 70-80% of their costs are the human costs. So that means, it's a real challenge, basically. Now, we have about 4,000 employees, but at least 2,000 employees belong to entities where really, we don't have reserves and those things, etc. So that's a real challenge. And what we are trying to do is trying to take employees into confidence that, we have to think about enterprise these days. Now, because this continues for another, 3 months, 6 months, and there is very, serious doubt whether we can even exist after that. Because whether we can, afford to take these kind of operational losses. So that's the challenge. And we have reduced our cost to extent possible in terms of negotiating rentals. And, the travel anyway has come down. We also asked people to take voluntary cut. We have come with some corporate principle to suggest that. And fortunately, we are able to do that, but I'm not sure whether we can do beyond 6 months' time. That is the challenge. The second and more important thing is that I'm sure that everybody, particularly people in the lower cadre, will undergo a lot of anxiety and sustainability, the concern. And it might lead to, we don't hope that to happen, but it might result into serious psychological pressure on people. And then, you might see some people even thinking of suicide, something like that. I know I'm more concerned about that because these people have been working with for so many years. So I don't see any magical solution for these problems, but it, only the solution is, I think, everybody has to think that the organization is ours and we have to survive and then retain our organization thing. And that's the only solution that will solve the problem. Thanks.
Thank you, Sadhya. Vijay?
I think if we look into the impact post-COVID, the impact is on the entire economy because the lockdown was total, right?
Yes.
Even government stopped functioning, private corporate businesses, everything stopped functioning, right? Essential services was functioning and other essential services, we had to kind of try to get it functioning. I was personally involved in some of getting these like financial services, financial inclusion services in rural through the VCs, get them running because government didn't allow them to run in the initial phase. So let's understand one thing very clearly, that the impact was not just on us, it was on everybody, right? That is uniform across. Second, if I say then social enterprise, NGOs and nonprofits have been the pillar stone of this country for a very, very long time. Let's be very frank and honest. Sometimes I feel that the social sector doesn't want to even acknowledge their own contribution in the sector itself, which is I think it's a foolish idea. They should acknowledge it with power and conviction that the politicians do when they don't actually contribute much. The social sector has been the backbone of delivery of services across the country. And again, in post-COVID situation, Vega was mentioning about the relief. Who did the relief? It was not the government who did the relief. Absolutely not. It was a social sector organization. It was the nonprofits. It was the individuals who work with the commitment and cost did that relief measures, right? And they pooled most of the funding that came was through individuals. Like Megha was mentioning, it was phenomenal response that came from individuals who were there because other organizations were not able to mobilize funds because of various constraints imposed by from travel and conviction as well as. Philanthropies like Ajim Premji Foundation came up very, very largely in support of many of these exercises. So there were some relief measures there. But if you see government support for the nonprofit, absolutely zero. There was no support by the government. In fact, the nonprofit offered their services free of cost, like Pradhan was mentioning, to the government, which was not required. I think we should have charged the government for doing that because the government response to the pandemic was very poor. Let's accept that for the fact. Plus, let's say when we talk about sustainability, I agree with what Satya is saying, that the sector is facing crisis. But that's not just post-COVID, that is pre-COVID as well. For last 5 to 6 years, funding has been cut by almost 50 to 60% for the sector, both private philanthropy as well as international donors, including government. The funding has been in cut by many, many times. And in post-COVID situation also, the government took away a major share of the CSR funding and the other funding which was available, which is pathetic because that government didn't require that fund. It was the organizations which were requiring the fund, which is again a failure of our policy and our collective action, where we couldn't emphasize that the funds are required by somebody else, not the government system, because government system already has sufficient funding and they can mobilize more amount of funds. Now coming to the future of the ecosystem, then I would put my faith in the social enterprises because, let's accept it frankly that the fault line of India's development for many, many years are very clearly visible. We have hidden it in fake data that poverty has reduced and so many jobs are there. We have hidden it across many multitudes of layers of fake data. And those fake data has completely been exposed in this pandemic. We have seen savings of people have been completely washed away. savings of urban middle, lower middle class have been completely reduced. We see all information is coming out. Gold pledging is rising like hell. People are pledging gold because just to survive. So these are very, very clear indicators that people are going into poverty. And that's very clearly we are talking about now, that post-COVID, who's going to work with these people? It is us, all of us, the social enterprise sector, the nonprofit sector is the one who has to take the responsibility, because government will not be able to offer jobs. Private corporate will not be able to offer jobs. It's the social sector who has to come up there. Now, the challenge is where would the funds come from, the social sector? To some extent, I agree with Megha that funds might be available from individuals. But frankly, if you look inside yourself, you will know that the amount of job losses which is happening in the economy, those funds will not come more than 6 months from now. It is institutional investment in non-profits and the social enterprises is the call for the day. I don't expect government to do it, unfortunately, but I expect that we need to kind of evolve, work towards a much more different kind of mechanism, which will there. But I think the time of social enterprise, if ever it was to come, has already come. We are there. We have to kind of mobilize. There's no other job left in the country. The only job left in the country is to rebuild the country. It's as simple as that.
Thank you, Vijay. We have about 5 to 7 minutes for you to respond to each other if you want to. Any point which popped up and you want to say, okay, I had something to add to that point or refute the point, you can do so. No specific order, you can choose whichever order you want to do.
So one thing I would like to add what Vijay said, that this pandemic at least exposed the weakness in our model of economy, that is growth center only in few urban areas. Now there is an opportunity for us to really expand the model to be spread out to cover rural areas. We have to see rural areas as the new economic engines, and then only this large-scale distress migration that we saw and what happened to them can be addressed only when we focus on making village life as worth as or more worth than urban areas. So that is one focus area for the civil societies, and I think government has come up with a scheme recently, but it's a short-term thing to provide jobs to migrant workers who have returned to the villages. But many such things need to come to see a better life in the rural area, to ensure a better life.
But Manas, if I just kind of build off your point a little bit, if you see, because of this pandemic, actually urban India has been more affected than rural India. If you think on multiple fronts, right? I mean, there are certain statistics that kind of prove that. So the highest GDP contributing cities have actually been affected. Take that Delhi, Delhi, Bombay, states like Gujarat, Karnataka, they have actually been more affected. I think while I agree that the focus is has to be on rural India, but I think this is the first time where we are learning that there needs to be a far more resilience that needs to be built out even in urban India. And so how do we rebuild? To your point, Vijay, around this is the time to rebuild India. I feel like this is a good lesson for us to also now, how do we look at our cities differently, and urban cities and urban planning from what we have in the past. I think it's the need of the hour, and we don't talk as much about urban India. The situation in urban slums is worse than what it is in rural India, and we are seeing that right day to day. We are reading about it. So I think for us, we've also been like, while we do focus on, of course, migration is a big conversation, but migration is also going to affect the urban cities equally, if not more. There needs to be a focus there. And that's where I also feel like government participation is quite required to be able to build this resilience in the cities, in the urban cities.
Sorry to come in here, but Megha, I think urban has been taken a lot of space already in India's development story for 70 years. It's time that urban should be given as, completely. Social sector doesn't need to work in urban. If the government want to step up in urban, please come and do, you're welcome. Social sector is not required for urban at all. who are the migrants living in slums? They who are the people? They are from rural area, not able to find livelihood. And that is where I think one thing which I would like to add to what Manas was saying earlier, I think what has also been exposed is the development sector, social sector's development model in rural India. They are also been a failure, dramatic failure. I would be very candid about pointing it out and accepting it that they have been dramatic failure, because we have largely created business models which have failed. We have seen that time and again, where production centers are rural and the market is urban. And when the supply chain disruption happens, you have seen that that none of those development models. Professor was talking about handicraft supply chain were disrupted enterprises. So if you look into large number of social enterprises, specifically the for-profit ones, you will find that all of them are not really working in rural. They're only working in this peri-urban and urban. You will not even find 5% of social enterprises in this country who are actually working in rural. They are not even going to rural. They're only working, cute little apps and cute little websites are being made, and they're only working in the surface of the development. Real development challenges in India is rural. If we stop rural, urban will not have a problem by default, simply because those migrations will not happen. We need to go back 70 years when Gandhi talked about Gram Swaraj. It was a principle of sustainability which was being talked about. If the principle of sustainability in any ecosystem, in any habitat, we are not able to assure, migration is a result of that. It is not, people don't want to come and live in slums all through their lives. It is not required. I think COVID is an opportunity for us to rebuild India bottom up, not other way around at all. Urban, I don't think even one social enterprise is required in urban. Urban can take care of itself, not required.
I mean, I'm almost tempted to ask that question to all of you, and because, you know, especially Vijay, and I know Pradhan and Basics also does a lot of work in rural India, but I mean, I completely agree your point, but what is your confidence level with the migrants that have moved back? Do you think they'll be able to sustain and survive in back home? Or even if they don't want to, and for all reasons that their dignity has been compromised above everything else in the current situation, do you think that they will be able to sustain? And so I often end up thinking that even if they don't want to come back to urban India, perhaps hunger is going to bring them back.
I can answer, but I'll request somebody else in the panel to answer that first.
See, what I suggested will be in the interest of both urban and rural area. This pandemic exposed that these migrants did not belong to the cities who contributed so much for the GDP growth. They did not belong to the villages also. So such situation, why have you landed up in such a situation? Because you have never seen rural areas as growth center. Don't you think all this production, marketing, agro processing, why can't it happen in rural areas?
Yeah.
Why this is the agro processing industry should be in the urban areas? So the model of economy that we have has to change, and this is an opportunity. We need to mobilize more and more resources to see growth in all the rural areas. Where the production happens, why can't the processing happen?
Yeah, so let me come here. Hello? Hello? Yeah.
Yes.
So I think that is a very valid point, that people who have migrated back to villages have to come back after some time, unless there is a good opportunity available. I don't think it is feasible for them to remain there. I think what's important is the government should heavily invest in the infrastructure in the rural areas. Like, for example, you can have a godown in every village, literally. That is a very basic need of an agricultural thing. And the government does not bother about it. And how much labor can be absorbed in this way? Actually, instead of giving free money, let them invest in huge infrastructure that is required in rural areas, particularly on the agriculture sector. So that must happen.
Yeah.
So let me give my perspective quickly on this. See, Megha and Manas, I think you're missing the picture here a little bit. Please understand that if you look into how India survived this crisis, it is not because of government. It is not because of even us, all of us. It survived because of small businesses. Small businesses, small farmers across the country came up because small farmers have a small supply chain. They deliver to 3 or 4 kilometers only. COVID blockage was not affecting them. Small farmers still was producing the vegetables and the small grains, whatever they have stored, they were supplying to the small areas. The small baniya shops, kirana shop stores, those were the ones supplying the local economy, because supply chain disruption was total. It was in 4 hours, it was announced foolishly. But if you just look into the disruption alone, who was supplying these stocks? Where the stock was moving? It was moving because the local supply chain of the baniya and kirana stores, they were the one connecting dots between this. India survived because of that. If you look into it honestly, then reality of the picture is that is what it survived. It didn't survive because of large business. It didn't survive because of the government supply of grains. Of course, government supply of the grains helped a little bit, but it survived because of that, right? So this is, we need to understand that where exactly the requirement is. If we are talking about 70% of the population, who 70 million people have gone back to the villages, do you think in MSME sector association is saying that in 1 year time we will be working at 30% of the capacity because we just don't have market demand? So MSME sector employs 95% of the population in this country. Now imagine, where will the 70% remain? They will remain in villages. They won't come back to the cities, right? So if you look into all data, everything is pointing that the effort should be back home, not here, because that is not required here at all. This, the demand, until the demand builds up, it will take 3 to 4 years to build the demand back to where we were today. Then only you can expect people to come back. Other than that, if they come back, they will have too little income to even survive in a city. It's not possible.
Mm-hmm. Any last thoughts anybody has on this?
Actually, we had conducted a survey and 60% of the migrants who have returned, they don't want to go back. The trauma that they have gone through, we can't realize that.
Yeah,
I know. And they don't want to go back. So unless we address their aspirations by investing in the rural areas, we will make a blunder, and certainly they will be forced to go, but they don't want to go back and live under such conditions that they live in the urban area. So it's an opportunity for all of us to revive rural economy so that we can retain most of them. At least people go for distress migration.
So, if I ask you briefly, maybe in two sentences or 2 points, what need to happen in social enterprise sector, either from government policy or ecosystem, so that next time our sector is much more capable and strong enough to respond to similar crises?
I would like to say one thing, like we have ease of doing business, we should have an indicator for ease of doing charity. This sector is not supported in this country adequately. We need to promote ease of doing charity in this country.
Manas, you have been very humble in saying that, but truth is that this sector is being targeted. And
that's what I'm saying.
That is why I'm saying you've been humble. You need to be blunt. Until unless the sector itself, nobody is going to stand up for you. See, you have a larger responsibility for 70% of the country. You can't be meek. You have to speak up. We need to speak up saying that we are the ones who are doing the job. Please stand aside. We will do the job. So that is what I think is needed. We need a lot of funds. Our funds have been cut down by 50% in last 5 years. We need actually 4 times the fund than was coming to us 5 years back. That is the only
fund
way.
Enabling conditions also.
Yeah, of course. That is the unfortunate part. That is where I think all of us should be targeting. We can't be soft in our approach. We have been soft too long. We need to stand up for ourselves if we are not. This is unfortunate that in this country, we can't trust the media. Media is gone, finished. We don't even know. Academics needs to stand up. Dasra kind of agencies who are doing research need to stand up. You can't have biased research anymore. You have to come up with the real data. You need to put the real data in the face of the institutions that are governing us. We can't. It is time that you stand up. And I've been saying this again and again, that it's too much. We have waited.
Thank you so much. We have only that much time. Thank you so much. Really appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Ishwar.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, everyone.
Yeah, thank you. Right.
So we're done in the time, and thank you so much for your really appreciate.
Yeah, yeah.
Hope to see you in person in the near future.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, everyone.
Thank you. Bye bye.